Thankful to be here this morning. It's a good way to spend a Saturday morning to preach. I always look forward to opportunities to preach, and you know, to get to do it on a Saturday is a good thing. To start off with, I want to tell you a story. There was a young boy who went on a field trip with his school, went to a museum, and as they're touring the halls of the museum, the boy's noticing all the different things, all the different exhibits. He notices the great big dinosaur bones, and he's fascinated, and he tries to take himself back and imagine what it would be like walking in the woods somewhere and hearing the thud of the dinosaur feet hitting the ground and how exhilarating it must have been to see them and how majestic they were, and went over into the ancient civilizations and was fascinated by all the artwork and strange-looking and strange-sounding languages that these ancient people spoke, and that they had their own thoughts and cultures and all those things just totally fascinated this young boy. The museum curator noticed him and noticed the interest that he took and took him aside and pointed out little interesting tidbits about the different exhibits that he may not have gotten by just simply reading the plaques. And he was just so fascinated, and he went home and looked up everything that he could find on how to grow up to be a museum curator. He kept studying. He corresponded with that museum curator who took an interest in him. Went through school, studied, loved every minute of it. Well, not every minute. They had tests, right? Finally, he got out of school and landed a position as a museum curator. And it was tough work. At first, he was excited, and at night, when everybody was gone, he'd walk the halls looking at the exhibits, delighting in all the interesting things that he got an opportunity to study up close. The second year that he was there, the antiquities market was flooded with a bunch of frauds. And after that, he was sort of disappointed by his work. He was searching out frauds and writing reports on them and trying to get insurance money for the frauds that the museum had purchased. And it was a blemish on his record. But he was vigilant in those things. After a time, he was even more depressed, and he thought his job was more corresponding with HR, dealing with payroll issues, putting up ADA compliance stickers, and chasing away those ratty little kids that were playing on the water fountain. You know, if his mentor could write him a letter, if his mentor could have written him a letter, it would have been very similar to the letter to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2. He'd forgotten what it was that he was all about and why he was doing that work in the first place. And all the things he was doing were good works, but he had lost the focus of what made it important. You read the book of Revelation, it becomes very clear that the theme of the book of Revelation is to overcome or to be victorious, both words translated from the original root. And that root occurs, I count, about 17 times in 15 verses in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 7 says, "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." And we can overcome through Christ who overcame himself. Revelation chapter 17 and verse 14 says, "These shall make war with the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings." You know, it's interesting when you read the book of Revelation, you see that victory has already been won. We just have to go through it. And in the end, we will win. John 16 and verse 33, Jesus said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you shall have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." The church in Ephesus knew what it meant to have tribulation. I like to think of them as sort of being in the kitchen. You know, they understood what it meant to take heat. They were a massive city. They were a center of pagan worship. The temple to Diana was something that people just flocked to engage in all manner of wickedness. And the people were very passionate about all of these wicked things that were going on. So they understood what it meant to go through these tribulations. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5, John writes, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?" And so it is that we can be victorious through Jesus Christ. Now, when you're looking at the letter to the church, well, the churches in Asia in general, you're going to see that there's those exhortations to overcome, and that is to overcome the thing at hand, the thing in the letter. There are certain things that each church needs to overcome, and those are not necessarily the same for each church. But in the context of the letters to the churches, the overcoming means you've got to deal with this issue. Otherwise, you are not going to be faithful. And so these letters are written to these churches to get them to be what they ought to be so that they could overcome. And so that's the way that I've structured this lesson. We're going to see some ways that Jesus Christ equipped the church in Ephesus to overcome the trials that they were facing. And the first of these is that you can overcome these things by knowing the Christ of God. As he begins the introduction letter, we read in Revelation chapter 2 and verse 1, to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, he that walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. If you're going to be faithful and you're going to overcome the trials that are facing you or in whatever situation that you're in, you're going to have to start off with understanding and knowing who Jesus Christ is. One of the reasons why all of these churches that go off into apostasy is because they don't recognize the authority of Jesus Christ. They don't know him. I like to say, I'm fond of saying this, in fact, in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 17, the problems and the failures regarding Colossians chapter 3 and verse 17 are actually Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1 problems, that they're not seeking those things which are above. And when you listen to denominational churches and some of our brethren, when they're trying to discuss what the church is supposed to be, they spend all their time talking about people and very little of their time talking about what would please the Lord. What would make the people happy if we did this? It'd make the people happy if we did this. Well, what would make the Lord happy? You see, they don't know the Lord. How is he described here? Well, he's the one that holds the seven stars in his right hand. If you read commentaries on that, well, brace yourself, because you're going to hear a lot of interesting ideas about what this means and what these stars are and how it relates to the rest of the book. One of them went off and wrote about 3 or 4 pages talking about how these were the seven planets or one particular constellation in particular. Well, okay, if that's what the guy wants to think, I think there's some more important things that you could glean from this. Sometimes people say that these represent individuals in the churches, perhaps the preacher. Well, the word angel is sometimes, it means a messenger and can be a humanly messenger. That's certainly true. I have a theory about it. I believe that these stars, that they represent angels. That's just my theory. I get that theory primarily because I read Revelation chapter 1, verses both 16 and 20, where we have it revealed to us that the stars are the angels. Somebody might say, well, that's figurative. Well, then what are the churches figurative for that the candlesticks represent? That's the second thing you learn about this, is that the candlesticks represent the churches. So I believe that they're angels. What is the meaning of that? If you're spending a lot of your time thinking about the angels, then you're missing the point of this and why it's introduced in the first place, and that is to tell us something about the Lord Jesus Christ, that he holds them in his right hand, and this is a tremendous power. These angels are held, they're, if you want to use the term, they're on a leash. The angels might not be very happy with me, but they're on a leash, so I can say such things. You look at the role that the angels play throughout the Bible, and you see that their awesome power with regards to Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis chapter 19. You see them standing guard over the garden in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 24. You see how it is that when they appear to Mary, they have to tell her, don't be afraid, because these are beings with tremendous power, and you see their role in so many different ways, and how it is in Exodus chapter 25, they're over the ark as the vindicators of God's holiness, and the only thing that stands between justice and the laws that is there is the mercy seat. And so the blood will be offered and keep us safe from the vindicators of God's holiness. So I'm glad that Jesus Christ holds these in his hand. And when I think about the wickedness that you read about in the churches of Revelation, the churches of Asia, they ought to be thankful that they're in his hand also. And so it is we learn something about the Christ of God. He's the one who walks among the lampstands. Well, this is a place of authority. This is a place of intimate knowledge about what's going on. He's among them. He knows. These things aren't hid from him. These things aren't far off so that he has to rely on some sort of corrupt news source to get his information about them. But he is well aware of all the predicaments that the churches in Asia are facing. He is among the lampstands. And so we learn about the Christ. Secondly, among the lampstands means that this is an offer of fellowship. God walked in the garden in Genesis chapter 3. He walked in the garden. That's an offer of his fellowship to these people. At the end of the epistle to the church in Ephesus there in Revelation chapter 2 and verse 7, there is an offer for these people to be with God in paradise and have access to that tree of life. And it's again repeated in Revelation chapter 22 and verse 1. And so it is in fact an offer of fellowship. The second thing, if you're going to overcome, you're going to have to know the consolation of God. And that's why it is that he starts these things off by saying, I know thy works. Why is it that we're wired this way? Well, nobody knows what I'm doing. I'm just going to give up. Well, you shouldn't give up. If you do give up for that reason, because nobody knows, then you'd be wrong. But it is, in fact, true that we sort of geared that way to enjoy and appreciate that consolation, and it helps us to steady our efforts and be encouraged in doing the works that we know we ought to be doing when we understand that somebody else knows what we're going through and is encouraging us in those things. And so the Lord begins this saying, I know thy works. And so it is that we ought to take comfort that our God in heaven knows the things that we endure. The psalmist said, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. And then in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 10, the Hebrews writer said, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor and love. And so it is that God is acquainted with the things that we go through. He knows the things that we face and the suffering and tribulation that we endure and all these things. But God provides for us so that we won't quit. We're not going to be weary in well-doing. And in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58, we're told to know that our labor is not in vain in the Lord. And so we can be encouraged by the fact that the Lord knows the things that we're going through. There's one other thing about this. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 17, you see something else about the right hand of Christ, the same one that held those stars. Verse 17 says, and when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand upon me. That's scary. The hand that's holding the tremendous power lays on it, but it's an expression of the consolation, encouragement that is offered towards John. And so it is that we can trust our God in all things. Thirdly, if we're going to overcome, we're going to have to know the commendation of God. It's not enough just to say, God knows what I'm going through. And I find a lot of preaching that's intended to be consolation and encouragement, I find a lot of it just stops at the point of God knows, God knows, God knows. Well, what is it that God knows? You've got to have some substance and understanding about precisely the things that God is pleased with in order to continue doing those things and to avoid the things that would displease God. And that's why it is that somebody sits through a bunch of sermons, God knows, God loves you, God cares about you, and you say, this is wrong. You're not doing something that's right. They've heard all those sermons saying, yeah, I am, because the preacher said that God loves me, knows what I'm going through, and is just super happy with me. Because there was no substance behind that expression of consolation. So you've got to know the commendation of God. And that's where we get into verses 2 and 3 of Revelation chapter 2. I've added verse 6 under the commendation, just in case you're wondering. But he writes, I know thy works and thy toil and patience, and that thou canst not bear evil men, and didst try them that call themselves apostles, and they are not, and didst find them false. And thou hast patience and didst bear for my name's sake, and hast not grown weary. But I have this against thee, that thou didst leave thy first love. And you bring in verse 6. He says, but this thou hast, thou hatest the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh, to him will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So firstly, when we're looking at this commendation and the specific substances involved in it, that Jesus Christ knows their works. He knows the work that they are engaged in. And this is the general term. And you understand that the Ephesians had knowledge about such things. You look at the list of faithful preachers that spent time in Ephesus. You look at the Apostle Paul. You look at the work of Apollos. You look at the work of Aquila and Priscilla. You look at the work of Tychicus and Timothy and the Ephesian elders themselves and Onesiphorus. And so you see that these people had good preaching and they knew about substance and they knew about good works. You can understand something about what they knew of good works when you look at the things that were written actually in the epistle to the Ephesians. For instance, in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, Paul writes, "For by grace are you saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works." A lot of people try to take that passage out of context and misunderstand the importance of faith in the salvation that comes through grace. And I always like to say, if y'all have heard me preach, you probably heard me say this, and I'm not going to quit, is that grace always comes in the form of a plan. And so faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You're not going to receive God's grace unless you do it through faith. And when God says to do something, you trust in him to do what he said to do. Well, that's a work. It's not your own work so that you can say, look at what I thought up. You know, I climbed Mount Olympus or, you know, overcame all of these mythological beings. And so I have access to the tree of life on what I did. That's not the way that it works. But the church in Ephesus would have known that we're his workmanship. And so works are intrinsically who we are as Christians, that works are necessary, works are involved. And if you're not doing them, you've given up your identity as a Christian. And so the church in Ephesus would have understood that. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13, talking about the armor of God, they understood that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having worked, you know, doing the works necessary to stand. You have to do those works in order to be standing. And so the church in Ephesus understood some things about works. The book of Revelation, likewise, has certain things to say about works, but this time I'm talking about works as they relate to judgment. Towards the end of the book, in Revelation chapter 20, verses 12 through 14, we have written, "I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works." You mean I'm going to be judged on the basis of works that I have performed? Yes, that is, in fact, what the Bible teaches. And so when the Lord writes to the church in Ephesus, "I know your works," and he's writing in the sense of commending them for doing those things, it is very substantial that these works were necessary. These works identified them as who they were, and there were works that they needed to continue in order to be faithful. The role of works. When understanding what he's writing here by way of encouragement, he says, "I know your works," and it's interesting that he breaks those down into several different categories, the broad term being works, and these works are expressed in two different ways. There is the effort that they've spent, you know, the output of effort, and then there's the endurance, talking about the passive side of these things. And on the output side, the things that they're engaging in, the works that they're doing, the first of those that he itemizes is that of toil. And that's different than just the general head term of works. It's talking about the labors they're engaged in, and it carries with it the idea that they're working to the point of exhaustion, that they are throwing themselves into this kind of work. What precisely is this toil that's being spoken of? Well, they can't bear evil men. And that was a good thing, by the way. Some people would say, well, that's bad. But it's good. The Lord commends them for that. They can't bear those wicked people. This wickedness that's described here, the lexicons describe it this way, pertaining to being bad with the implication of harmful and damaging, bad, evil, harmful, or harsh. And so you start to understand that there was wickedness that would come in among the church in Ephesus, and they took to heart what was said in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And so they understood what this meant, and they engaged in that as they were directed to by the Apostle Paul. Well, these evil ones that came in among them, whom they could not bear, they weren't willing to put up with it. Who were these people? Some have said that this was a different group from those who were claiming to be apostles. Some have said that these were the same group as those claiming to be apostles, or that it was a subset or some configuration of that. But regardless of what you think, the thing that you see there that's being commended is these people were not going to be putting up with things that were contrary to the doctrine of Christ. And so you see that they weren't going to put up with it, but their efforts in rejecting false apostles were well placed. These people were not simply tilting at windmills, so to speak. There was a real threat from somebody who would come into a church and say, I'm an apostle and here's what you need to start doing. And those people would turn out not to be who they said they were. You mean that can happen? Well, you know, we have records of it in the New Testament. Like, for instance, the mention of false apostles in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13 through 15. And it shouldn't surprise us that that kind of thing would happen because, you know, Satan wants to appear as light. And so you have his ministers being as ministers of light. And so it shouldn't surprise us that some people would try to deceive. Some people's doctrine prohibits them from thinking about such things, but that's not the doctrine that you read about in the New Testament. It is a fact that we have to be aware of the dangers in churches of people coming in not being who they say that they are. The Apostle Paul said to the elders in the church of Ephesus, there in Acts chapter 20, verse 29, that after his departing, grievous wolves shall enter in among them, not sparing the flock. And so it is that we have to be aware and on guard against those who had come in under false pretenses. The Bible also describes, the New Testament in particular, describes the efforts that are necessary in proving those who are making these claims. Like, for instance, in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1, where John writes, Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. And then we see in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 21, to prove all things and to hold fast that which is good. And so we have the signs of an apostle in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12, whereby we can say, if you're an apostle, I want you to substantiate that claim with the evidence which is required to prove that what you're saying is true. Do the works. And these people would come in, they're saying, we're an apostle, fine, prove it. They're not, they can't prove it, get rid of them. It was as simple as that. It's interesting to me that there is a different word that's used here from the word try in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1. It's a different word that means testing of sorts. It's a word that's often used with regards to temptation. It's the word that's used, examine yourselves, in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. And I think that probably there's a contrast being made here between the word used in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1, which is more like scrutinizing a proposition to see if whether or not it's true. And the other one, if you look at the lexicons, they don't put it in these terms, but I kind of say take it for a test drive. You know, try it on for size. You say you're an apostle. We're going to keep our eye on you. Who are you really? We're watching you. And so that's more like the term that's being used in the book of Revelation concerning what these people did, and they found them to be liars. They said they were apostles, and they found them to be liars. Now, I realize that a lot of people will say, well, that's unloving. You can't say that. Maybe they were just mistaken. Well, they were mistaken when they told that lie. They shouldn't have done that. But the Bible calls them liars. Revelation chapter 21, verse 8 tells us that all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire. But let's look at some other things in the New Testament that talk about those who are liars. And I think that maybe that's why the difference in terms is being used here. Not in that they were looking at the proposition they are apostles, but they were looking at the larger sphere of life of these people making this claim and found some other things amiss among them. Notice in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 6, John writes, "If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie." Well, that's one type of liar. Maybe this is what these people were doing. In 1 John chapter 1 and verse 10, "If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar." Well, that's if you make him a liar because Jesus Christ is not a liar and you're saying he's a liar, well, that makes you a liar. Write that down and you can go back and reread it later. This is another way of lying, though. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 4, "He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar." These people may have been saying, well, I know him, and then there was some commandment in particular that the church in Ephesus could see, you're not doing that, and so you're a liar. In 1 John chapter 2 and verse 22, "Who is a liar but he that denieth Jesus is the Christ?" And we understand that this is something that was abundant in the time period in which the book of Revelation was written, is that people were actually denying things about who Jesus Christ was. And then again in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 20, "If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen?" Your theology is going to have real-world consequences. And so there is the relationship there between how you treat your brethren and how well you know God, and then it feeds on itself and it either grows or descends one way or the other, but you have to build up both sides of that. But then you have expressly their efforts in rejecting the Nicolaitans. Who are the Nicolaitans? I don't know. And if you think you know, you probably don't. The early sources are pretty sketchy at their very best. We have some say that the word Nicolaitan in itself means a smushed together word talking about those who are conquerors, you know, Nike, and then laos of the people. And so, you know, that may have been what they called themselves. It may have been what the church has called them. You know, we have names for people that they don't use for themselves. They don't like it, but if they're appropriate, I'm not going to quit calling them. If they're liberals and they don't want to be called liberals, tough, quit being liberal. So maybe this was a word that the Lord used for them. Maybe it was a word they used, the churches used for them. Or maybe it was what they called themselves. Others have said that this relates to Nicholas that you read about in Acts chapter 6. Well, I think that's not fair, and they should apologize to Nicholas because there's no evidence that says that he went off on some false doctrine. What do we know about these people? They're wrong. They needed to be opposed. And the Lord hates them. And Brother Danny made mention of that. But in this world today of tolerance, what do you hate? You're going to have to hate something. What is it that you hate? You better be hating the right things. In fact, I understand the sentiment that's used when people use those catchphrases. And I think sometimes people have a mantra faith where they create phrases and they follow those as a matter of faith rather than the text of the Word of God. And people say things like, well, you have to love the sinner and hate the sin. Well, in Psalm 5 and verse 5, we find that the Lord hates the workers of iniquity. He hates the workers of iniquity. And in Psalm 119, verse 104, we learn that through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. If you don't hate the false ways, you do not have understanding. And the Bible requires us to have understanding. That's how it is that you're wise. That's how it is that you fulfill your responsibility to walk circumspectly. And if you're not doing those things, you're unwise and you're a fool. And the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. You think that you can love the things that the Lord hates? You are a fool. And you're living like there's no God. And the church in Ephesus understood that to their credit, that they hated the Nicolaitans. But then other things that they're commended for their patience. I already told you they were in the kitchen, so to speak, and they had been through a lot of things. And I like to look at this term patience that's translated patience, and literally it talks about those who are abiding under. They're under a tremendous amount of pressure. They're under a lot of tribulation. They're going through those things, but they're standing fast. They're going through it, and they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. Moulton and Milligan, about this word, writes it this way. He says it denotes an inward feeling as well as outward conduct, but directed only towards aggression. And then he says, hence, in late Jewish literature, the word is frequently applied to the virtue shown by martyrs. And these people, the church in Ephesus, they had this patience. But I want you to look at something. In James chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, James had something to say about, you know, the effects of patience if it's allowed to do its work and what you can have patience in. He says in verse 3, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, but let patience, in other words, you do this, do the letting, let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. The church in Ephesus wasn't allowing that to take place. They were lacking in certain things. They had the patience, but they didn't allow it to carry them forward to where they needed to be. There are two areas of patience. Well, they were bearing up under certain things, and there's an interesting word play on the bearing and the endurance. In other words, you know, you have labored to the point of exhaustion, but you have not given up. And then he has the word play also, you're unable to bear false teachers. You're not going to shoulder that burden, but you've shouldered burdens for my name's sake. And so they were shouldering a lot of burdens. And so they demonstrated their patience by not giving up, but also in dealing with the things that they needed to deal with. And in you see in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2 and Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2, bear ye one another's burdens. And then in verse 5, for every man shall bear his own burden. Burden used being two different words used in two different ways. But there are things that we've got to bear as a matter of being faithful in Christ Jesus. And the church in Ephesus was bearing certain things. They were shouldering those burdens. And their patience finally was demonstrated in their endurance. I like to look at John chapter 4 and verse 6 to understand, you know, the labor to the point of exhaustion that's expressed there and why it's similar and how you can get a flavor for the word when it says that Jesus, therefore, being wearied, you know, he had toiled. And so the church in Ephesus, they weren't giving up. They weren't sitting down to take a breather, so to speak. They were continuing on steadfast in their endurance in these trials that they were going through. But then if you're going to overcome, you've got to know the correction of God. And this is where you can get tremendously unpopular. If you're going to overcome, you've got to know the correction of God. Jesus Christ says this. He says, but I have this against thee. And I'm using the American Standard Version as the text of the book of Revelation. But I have this against thee, that thou didst leave thy first love. Remember therefore whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I come to thee and will move thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. These people had left their first love. Let that sink in for a second. This is their sin. Out of all the sins that you could be accused of, probably if you say, what would be the worst one? Probably most people don't think about this, but think about what that means. You have left your first love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 1, if I speak with tongues, you know, and you don't do it with love, what are you? You're just a bunch of noise. This is what these people are being accused of. I was talking with a brother in Christ on the word that's used there for having left, and it's word otherwise translated forgiveness, sent off in different contexts, and it's a variant of that word, but understanding that it's in the aorist tense there, and so it is that we're talking about something that's a done deal. I think in particular, the way that it's being used here means that you dropped me like a bad habit. This other brother disagreed with me. He said that it's, you know, the consummation of these things. And when he was describing this, you know, it may have been a long, drawn-out process, but it's marking the end of it, the leaving of it. But it reminded me of a book I read where it was talking about this guy who had been traveling in the desert, and he'd been carefully rationing his water out of his canteen. He got the last drop out and continued on several more miles. He would get thirsty, and he'd raise the canteen to his lips, and all it would do is sear his lips. And so it was pain to him, and he threw away the canteen. It doesn't matter which way it is. This is a done deal. This church did not have love. And this is the accusation that the Lord says specifically about them, that these people had left their first love. What is their first love? I have trouble with this. This could mean that it was first in terms of prior, or it could mean that it's first in terms of primary. I always want to take it in terms of primary, but you know, the lexicons, when they reference this, most often they take it in terms of prior. But either way, it tells us about the gravity of the situation. The firstness of their love, you look about it as talking about prior. You can read Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 2 and the similar affections of the heart of the people of Judah in leaving God, where he says, "Go and cry in the ears of Jerusalem, saying, Thus saith the Lord, I remember thee, the kindness of thy youth and the love of thine espousals, when thou wentest after me in the wilderness in a land that was not sown." And so it was that these people may have waxed cold in their affections for God in this sense. If you take it to mean the primary sense, well, no other verse can be more important in this than Matthew chapter 22. What is the greatest commandment? To love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. They had stopped doing this. They had left it. They had put it off. They were just as much done with this as God is done with somebody's sins when he forgives them. It's gone. Theories on love. If Buddy loved me, he would give me more time.
If you love me, keep my commandments.
Theories on love. Some people say that this means that they failed to love one another. I don't think that that fits the text. Now, understand, I'm not saying that they weren't failing in this regard. That's not the question. The question is that what Jesus meant when he wrote it? If you don't love God, that's going to affect the way you treat your brethren. And if you don't treat your brethren right, that's a reflection on how you love God. So I understand that that's true. I've already mentioned that. But I don't think that this is what the Lord is talking about in writing this. I know the Ephesians had their love for all the saints, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 15, and I understand that it's demanded, but you understand that when you're looking at it this way, is part of the problem, the assumption that's built into thinking that this is what that means, it takes the second commandment to love your neighbor and makes it the first commandment. And so I don't think that that's what's being talked about here. Others say, well, that this is a mechanical, cold obedience. Well, I don't think that that's really true. And I think that there's the built-in assumption when this is the way that you believe it. I think there's the built-in assumption that doctrine is somehow boring and cold and that commandments are somehow boring and cold. And I think that nothing could be further from the truth. When I study the doctrine, I'm excited about those things. Do you have a museum curator's faith? Some people have that, but the doctrine is exciting. So I don't believe that that's what's being described there. When you look at the Ephesians, they were toiling to the point of exhaustion. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, the same word concerning their toil is used, translated there as wail. So it's talking about an emotional expression, even in the way that they were enduring these things. And then without regards, they had hated the Nicolaitans. This is a people that is full of passion for the things that they thought they needed to be doing. They were not cold and mechanical. That's not what's meant by this. What does it mean that they had left their first love? Well, I think that there is some intentional ambiguity about these things, but it was a serious charge. I think about what the Apostle Paul wrote as a prayer for these people when he said in Ephesians 3 and verse 14, "I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God." You know, they may have gotten stuck in the labors of finding the frauds and dealing with the serious tribulations that they're facing and forgot to draw in all the beauty and wisdom of God's word and to carry on in the love of Christ. Jesus Christ warns about these things in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 12 when he said, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But these people in the church in Ephesus had become, at least in some way, like the Pharisees. These you have ought to have done and not left the other undone. They had started neglecting necessary works. What was that first love? What was characterized by first works. And they needed to remember from whence they had fallen. And that word that's translated fallen there is used in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 12. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he stand take heed lest he fall. These people, the church in Ephesus, was out of fellowship with God. And if you bid them Godspeed, you say they're doing a good work over there. They're catching false apostles by the day. The church in Ephesus was out of fellowship with God. You say, well, yeah, Geoff, they have a lampstand. Well, so did Laodicea. There were seven of them, remember? It was an offer of fellowship. They were told that they needed to repent. Why don't you tell somebody they need to repent? They only read one chapter a day. You need to repent of that because, you know, repent therefore of this thy wickedness. I perceive thereon a gall of bitterness. You need to read two chapters a day. This isn't something they had done better. They had left their first love. They were sinners, and at some point in time, the blood of Christ stopped cleansing them from unrighteousness. They were out of fellowship with God. They needed to repent, and they could overcome, and they could have access to the tree of life. Thank you.